early morning. My name is Christoph Pettis, and we're talking today about living with object relational mappers. We'll talk all about what those are and why you should care. So first thing, especially for the DBAs, you get called out to a client or an intern, you know, the internal facility, and they say, oh my God, this query is taking forever. Our DBMSs are the most horrible thing in the entire world. Why are they suck? Why do they run so slow? And you look at the query, because you go into the Postgres logs or something like that, and it's this horrible thing with 50,000 clauses in the where. It's doing all the, you know, it joins across 12 tables. You'd say, well, you just need to change this where clause. And they cut you off and they say, we can't change the SQL, we're using an ORM. So this happens to me all the time. So we're going to talk about ORMs, like what one is, why we have to put up with them at all, what are they good at, what are the problems with them, why can't we just make them go away, and the answer is no, you can't, sorry, and how we can live with them. So to introduce myself, Christoph Pettis, I'm a consultant with PostgreSQL Experts. I've been there since 2009. I've been using Postgres since 1998. I actually still have a 7.2 instance up and running. I really should upgrade it right now, but the uptime is like, sort of become this fascination for me to see how long I can keep it going without rebooting. My original background before I got into databases was as an application system architect, so I kind of like came out of that world, which has given me a somewhat more, I don't know, benign attitude towards ORMs than a lot of database people. And I actually designed ORMs for a bunch of languages. Does anyone ever remember a company called Taligent? No. one person, I'm impressed. Yeah, it was a joint venture between Apple and IBM and HP that went absolutely nowhere in Apple's search for a new operating system. And that was one of the first, that was an ORM component back in 1993, I believe. Okay, so the first part about ORMs is, ORMs are designed to bridge two different worlds. And a lot of the characteristics, both good and bad, about ORMs come from this intersection of them. So, the two worlds are object-oriented programming, which is what these days pretty much every new application and the vast majority of existing applications are written in a language that has some kind of OO capabilities, depending on the extent they use them. And relational database management, which is what we're all here about. So let's talk a little bit about object-oriented programming and what is it about OO that makes an ORM interesting or useful? So when in doubt, let's ask Wikipedia. So object-oriented programming is a programming paradigm using objects. Well, we probably could have kind of guessed that. The problem is, if you ask three programmers what OO is, you're going to get five different answers. So, but I want to focus on something very specific here about what's going on. So the definition goes on, data structures consisting of data fields and methods together with their interactions to design applications and computer programs. Okay, fair enough. So what's the critical feature of object-oriented programming? Any responses? What if the one adjective or noun that defines it? No one's had coffee. Okay. Is it data abstraction? Well, no. I would say that you could do data abstraction in almost any design paradigm. Is it messaging? I mean, messaging is what we decided to call procedure calls because calling procedure calls seemed like something your dad did. Modularity. I mean, Ada had modules, and it was an OO when it first came out. Polymorphism. I would say no, but it's getting warmer. You can build polymorphism on top of almost any language like C, but we're getting there. Inheritance? No, not really. I'm going to argue that the critical feature, the thing that makes an OO program different from almost any other, is encapsulation. And this is regardless of the language itself, but the design paradigm of object-oriented programming. So, talk about encapsulation a bit. In encapsulation, objects export behavior, not data. Yes, plenty of languages that we all know and love, Python, PHP, Java, if you set it up right, if you use public, you can get at the data in objects just fine. But the basic notion is that's an optimization. So, it's a shortcut when you expose them. It's because you didn't feel like writing getters and setters for all this stuff. Which you probably should have, but you didn't. Objects don't always have significant behavior, but that's kind of a degenerate case. That's because a lot of languages, there is no struct, so you just use an object for passive data. And so what object-oriented programming is all about is wrapping up the behavior of the data into a single package, the object. That's what it's about. This is, seems like programming 101, but it's important to understand why ORMs have the behavior they do, to understand what this particular characteristic of an object-oriented language. Everybody willing to at least ride with me on this one? So let's talk a little bit of, you're running your program and there are a bunch of objects, and what are the relationships between these guys? How are they all bound together? Basically, an object model is a collection of graphs. No big surprise there. Objects refer to each other. There, you know, you can call them pointers or references or, you know, swizzlers or strong refs or weak refs or, you know, blah, 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 blah. You can call them whatever you want, but, and each language has its own way of handling these kinds of references. They're direct hard pointers, they're some kind of smart pointer, they're reference counted, they're references, they're anything, depending on the language, but they all point to each other. They have these references that you follow. You know, ultimately derived from the notion of a pointer. So, ultimately, it's all this in-memory object graph. Okay, no big surprise there. So, you say, well, yeah, but okay, you can have arrays of these things and that kind of thing, and that's a different kind of relationship, and that's, in some ways, true. But each object has its own list of references to other objects. So, you have an array object that's either a real object or some kind of funny language construct, depending on the language. But it's managing this array of things. The shape of this graph is generally an application architecture decision. And what I mean by that is, when you're designing your application, you're specifying what kind of data structures are in this thing. You're not, these are general, the contents of the data structures obviously change dynamically all the time. It'd be kind of a boring program if they didn't. But the kinds of structures and their nature, you write the array declaration, you populate the array, all very straightforward and boring. So the collections aren't intrinsic to the objects, but they're internal structures. So generally the objects, unless the objects are dumped into the array, they don't have a fundamental notion of I'm an array object unless you're working on one of these old benighted OO languages that had the notion of collectible, which thankfully we've pretty much gotten away from over the years. And object classes are largely static. Now I know all the Python people are about to jump in on me, but work with me here for a second. The classes themselves are generally static for the life of the application. You can create new classes. Plenty of dynamic languages can create new classes and things like that. I understand that. But in the general conceptual sense, the list of classes, of base classes at least, is static for as long as the application runs. And if you create new classes, they're in reference to these existing classes. You can sometimes manufacture new classes completely on the fly, but you need specialized language tools to be able to get at them because you need some kind of specialized syntax to grab at them. You know, dynamic languages, yes, I get it. We understand that, but there's still a fun, it's very difficult to create a whole new class ab initio with no reference to any other class because at some point you had to syntactically write a reference to it. So, and that means, in these cases, it's an application change to add new methods and members to these objects. Again, dynamic languages will let you do this to an extent, but creating a new fundamental base class is basically something you do when you change your application. And generally, you have to be, even when you're creating these new these subclasses, like the Django ORM creates a new class for every model class in it that you use, but it's only in reference to an existing base class. Okay, how are we doing so far? Glazed over. Questions? Comments? Dead silence. Okay, cool. Typo? Sure. Make sure of them, yeah. Well, for somebody, English second language, I guess. Okay, that's, yes, to make use of them. Thank you. The object instances themselves are transient, unless you do otherwise. Objects of first and foremost are in-memory data structures. Okay. They're ultimately, no matter how many levels of indirection, how many different kinds of ways you have of accessing them, there's a hunk of memory that is the object, or hunks. Object persistence is a layer that's added on top of the object model. And there really isn't any production object-oriented language that assumes persistence as the default condition, where without taking any special pains, the object persists across application executions. Does anyone know of a contrary example? I thought I couldn't think of one. I know the research languages and things like that, but for people, that's a production language with deployed code, I don't think there is any. Basically, everything has a persistence layer that's dropped on top of it. And even object databases, and there are some, you have to mark the objects, and that makes sense. For objects, languages that are use int as a primary, you don't want to assume every single instance of an int gets hammered onto a disk somewhere. The performance characteristics would probably not be delightful in that case. So, if you're using object store or something like that, you still have to say this class or this instance of this class, please record this on in some kind of persistent store. Otherwise, it's just a transient data structure. So, to summarize, the OO paradigm. The objects export a set of behaviors. The application supplies the data. So when it instantiates this object, it says, okay, based on this relatively static behavior, here's some data. Please, I've now created this object. Please behave in the way you wish. If you want different behavior, you need different objects. You need to create new classes. So that's my quick rundown on object-oriented programming. This isn't fundamentally an object-oriented programming class, I wanted to set some ground rules. Questions, comments, thoughts about that? Cool. Okay. So now on to the relational model. This is a database conference. This is a little more interesting to everybody. So these are rules from E.F. Codd's book. So the information rule. Basically, everything's a table with rows and columns, and there's nothing else. There are no other interesting data points in the database besides the things that are at the intersections of rows and columns in a particular table. That's its rule. When you change an application, when you make changes to the underlying representation, the application program shouldn't have to care about that. It can still access it in largely the same way, the select will work no matter how you've hammered this particular thing on disk or what implementation you have. Cool. He's a little unclear actually in this rule whether it means changes, but generally, changes to the database, except in so much as the application is expecting those changes, shouldn't change their ability to work with the data. And this kind of sounds like exactly the opposite of what we talked about, or close to it. So in the relational model, data is primary. The relational database stores the data and makes it available to the application. That's what it does. It doesn't know or care about the applications that access it. It provides a data access API, and the application is trundling it. It doesn't know or really care what happens to this data. Yes, modern databases all have ways of moving application logic into the database, but from a conceptual point of view, these are not fundamentally application objects. These are ones to support the data storage model. So stored procedures, got it. Which is to say, the behavior it has is data-centric, not application-centric. As an application optimization, sure, people shovel application and business rules into the database all the time and start procedures. But conceptually, for example, a trigger is there to ensure data integrity in the data model, not to implement the application. Obviously, that's a fuzzy area. You can quote any number of applications that have moved business logic into the database. But from a conceptual point of view, what the database does is it stores the data, and it doesn't care what the application is about. So we talked about relationships in the object model, so let's talk a little bit about relations. I guess relational databases are about relations. An RDBMS has no predefined relationships. Just categorically state that. There are no predefined relationships at all in a relational database. Foreign keys are not predefined relationships. Foreign keys are declare integrity constraints, but they're only secondarily about relationships. Obviously, this microphone and I have much to learn about each other.
Let's try cutting it all a little firmer here. Much better.
Okay. Foreign keys fundamentally are about integrity constraints. If this record, this record only has meaning if these records exist, or this field, don't allow this field to fail to refer to another one. But there's nothing that this, it does not, foreign keys do not exclusively define all the relationships in a database. Frequently, they don't even necessarily optimize any more than an index would access to them. You can join any way you want in RDBMS, even if it makes absolutely no semantic sense whatsoever, as long as you can make it work semantically. A foreign key relationship may optimize it, an index may optimize it, but it's that's an optimization. That's not fundamentally valid. I think we have a subtle weak clip here.
Try this.
Stay, thank you. So what's important about this is you make up the relationships at runtime. There are no static relationships like this in a relational database. If you have a hierarchical database or some other architecture, that's different. But. So, the relation and the relations themselves are dynamic. By relations, that's a fancy term for the general case of a table. So, Postgres uses this term frequently. It's somewhat inconsistently in the documentation about a relation versus a table. But for right now, think of a relation as the general case of a table. So we have these two different statements. Conceptually, these both do the same thing, which is create a relation. One of them creates one that lasts a while, unless you put temporary at the end. One of them is extremely transient. It only lasts until the data has had a chance to get back to the client. But there's nothing logically different about them. You can take this and embed it and use it like at any table, and it just throws it away at the end. And you really can't have an RDBMS that works without doing this. This is basically what RDBMSs are about in the relational model, is creating and destroying these transient, these virtual transient relations all the time. So, databases kind of don't make much sense without persistence. With all due respect to the NoSQL people, kind of if you restart the machine, you kind of expect to get the data back that was there before. So the default operational model is let's store the data and get it back to you. Temporary and transient data is kind of a special case. It's the results of a select. You have to specifically declare a table as temporary. There are views which are relations that are calculated on the fly. But the basic operational model is hammer the data onto the disk. So those are the two worlds. You have in objects, you have a mostly static typing system with an extremely dynamic typing system for relational databases. You have encapsulated data in the object model versus exposed data in the relational model. You have bound behaviors in the case of the object model versus external behaviors in the case of the relational model. The bound behaviors are bound into the object in the OO model. In the relational model, the behaviors sort of trundle up and see what data are available to them. And explicit persistence versus assumed persistence. The explicit persistence of the OO model, you have to say, okay, save this for me, please. As opposed to the relational model, where simply creating a table, you're implying persistence. So, and the problem is ORMs were designed to bridge these two worlds. And we'll talk a little bit about why and the history of how we got here. And with varying degrees of success. And different ORMs approach this problem differently. So we'll talk a little bit about how these ORMs, about the different ways ORMs handle this kind of bridging. There are two general families of ORMs. There's the RDBMSUP one, which is the slightly older one. Hibernate's an example of this, where it was designed to work on existing databases. And then there's the application down one, where the idea was the application drives creation of the data model. So, okay. Questions, comments while I take a drink of water? Thoughts? That all make sense? I was expected to be beat up about the foreign key comment. Everyone's still asleep? Okay, cool. Let's see if we can continue to wake up here. Okay, let's talk about talk about Planet Orm, of the two worlds. So, the problem. The application programmer needs to get the data relational database. Okay. That's a pretty common problem. The application programmer is handed an SQL manual. Let's say we're in the early 90s. Say, oh, yeah, okay, here's the API. Thunk. And the application programmer says, oh, great, okay, got it. And starts writing code. And the code looks kind of like this. So we declare this cursor object, and you call this DB connection created, and we say, okay, well, let's find an order. And then we do say, oh, I have to learn how to do a select. Okay, I kind of wasn't counting on that. So we do this select, and oh, right, I have to use a star here, and I'm not sure why, but it just says do a star because otherwise it breaks. And we declare a result set, which is this object that I have to do, and I do a fetch results, and I kind of have to know that there's one object here because there's an order. I'm not sure why that works, but I played with it till it works. And now I have to start copying the fields out of it, and then I quit and become a tour guide because I'm going to realize my entire rest of my life I'm going to be writing functions like this. So that's not acceptable. Well, programmers are being programmers. They say, oh, okay, got it. What we need is an interface layer so I don't have to write this stupid code all the time. So, well, let's see. A tuple in a database is a collection of fields. That's okay, got it. An object has members, which are data fields. Okay. A table is kind of like a type. You know, you create this table, it persists, it has a set of fields. That all, okay. And a class is a type that has fields and persists, and you know, frequently they kind of have the same name. You know, I have an order table and an order object. You know, it's all sort of kind of makes sense. Huh, okay. I know, I got it. We'll map a class to a table. Each of the columns of the table can be a member of the instance of that class. I am a genius. And we can create and save methods on a base class or something. I guarantee you, every single programmer who has ever had to write to a database before the existence of an ORM for their language had this thought. And we can keep a flag in the object that says, has this been written to disk or not? Or I know, we'll just set the primary key field to null, to an empty pointer, and then when we write it on disk, we'll set that, and that's how we know we can write it on disk. And we'll figure the rest out later. How hard can it be? So, we write this. Okay, we just do this customer order retrieve, and this, and we cancel the order because we didn't want that guy's business, and we save it, and we're done. Wow, life has suddenly become 100 million times better. I do not have to quit my job. Problem solved. Just a few details. One or two. You know, we can. So, like, how do we know to do that? You know, do we have to write this big accessor method? Well, that's gross. We don't want to, you know, have to write these giant marshalling and unmarshalling methods. People have done serialization in objects, and that's no fun at all. So, how do we know to create a new row for a new object we've instantiated? Do we do this nil pointer thing, but what if it's an integer and not a pointer? We could reserve a value of zero to mean this hasn't worked. This hasn't been, okay. That's an interesting question. So joins. Yeah, okay. That's interesting. Well, people don't do joins, do they? I mean, I actually had people say, it's like, well, how often do you really do a join? This is from an application programmer. It's like, because there is no object that corresponds to the results of this join. So what do we do? Huh, okay. Well, how bad can it be? Couldn't be that hard. Yeah, we'll figure it out. And then, so in the history of these things, I mean, we were having these conversations in the early 90s at the latest, back when we were trying to figure out how to do this with C++ and Ada. And then 1998, and Comic Sans came along. Back then, Java was kind of language of choice. That was kind of what the cool kids were using. But RDB masses were still kind of in the hands of the priesthood. You know, you had specialized data people. You bought these really expensive Oracle licenses. So there was this distinction, and the application programmer wasn't expected to come up with a schema. People can quote any number of counterexamples, but that was kind of the culture that back then. We hadn't moved to today's model. But there's a lot of money to be made writing out a database-centric program. I mean, basically, startups were throwing money left and right on really, really expensive database editors, you know, where the you presented a web page that edited your underlying pet food database, you know. So suddenly, learning about databases and editing these things and not writing all that code became really important. And we needed a solution, like now, please, because we're not going to teach these people how to write these complicated joins, and we're not going to be, you know, anyone with a pulse who, you know, can claim to know Java gets a job. So, and no one's going to use J2EE. I mean, let's not be crazy here. So, so along came your DBMS approach, pioneered by Hibernate. Still in use to this day, Hibernate version 3. The idea here basically was you design a database schema because smart, you know, people, really well-compensated people who understand databases, were finally getting some respect, design the schema. And then you write these mapping files because the way you did things back then was XML. If you were doing XML, you were not serious. Only, you know, XML was the way you showed you were a real programmer back then. And then use the ARM to convert results into collections of objects via these mapping files. And it has its own, even has its own query language, which looks exactly like HTML or like SQL, but is called has an H. Okay, and colons. Colons are important. So the problem is solved. Ta-da. Okay. Oh, yuck. Okay. For some definitions of solved, I guess. So, okay, we're getting there, but still some problems. We don't have tedious object copying. Huge advantage. And I'm not being sarcastic, unlike most of this talk, about that object copying stuff really blows. And anything you do to get away from it is important. But, so we did tedious XML files instead. Okay, that's, I guess, an advantage. You only have to write it once. All right. It's better for some definitions of better. You don't have to learn SQL. And we're going to come back to this point over and over again because you didn't even, but you didn't have to learn HQL, which is basically SQL, except you use the object names instead of the column names. Okay, I guess that's better. Whatever. But one thing Hibernate did that was very good is you can model these joins in the XML file. So that there doesn't have to be a one-to-one mapping between object classes and tables. So if you you can't create these joins super easily on the fly, at least, you know, I'm talking like Hibernate version 1. Hibernate's gotten much more sophisticated over the years. But you did get joins because, again, database people were largely driving this, and they knew about joins, and they were said, well, if you can't do joins, you're not really solving the problem. You do have to create object classes for the results, but, you know, that's Java. You have to model it in an object somehow. Unless you do it as associative array. You can't do that, of course. Then came along this idea of annotations. It's like, once Java got annotations, they said, okay, let's jettison this XML file, because except for people who are really, really obsessive, no one likes these giant XML files. I mean, there are people who claim to, but I think they're kind of like have Stockholm syndrome. You know, they've been abused and they've been beaten by these XML files a lot. They think they're on their side. It's like, why don't we, all these do is say, this field equals this column, this field equals this column. You know, it's like, this is really stupid. Let's just say, use Java introspection and create this XML, you know, the mapping file, essentially, on the fly. And then annotations came along, well, this is a lot nicer. You know, you have to create these tuplizers, which basically, you know, that copy code we didn't want to write? Ta-da, it's back. But, okay, it's, you know, getting there. You know, there's not too horrible. And we can specify the mapping in the code. No one asked it. One less thing to get wrong. I mean, one of the things I never understood about these XML files is you're moving something the compiler can check from something the compiler can check in the form of the Java into this XML file, which the compiler can check. And you just get a runtime error. Okay, and for some definitions, that's good. Okay, whatever. My brain's too small. I don't get it. We use Java introspection to calculate the schema. Okay, not bad. Oh, of course, you know, the schema actually has to match. You have to get it right. You know, it's or you get these somewhat obscure exceptions flying out of the bowels of Hibernate. But okay. But come on, why can't we just create the class? We're still having to write all this stuff in two separate things. Eventually, this became the don't repeat yourself principle in Python. So why don't we examine the schema? and create a class from it. Okay, interesting idea. Not so easy in the Java era. You know, unless you're using something like Ruby or, you know, a dynamic language that runs across top of JVM. But, you know, spitting out these Java files, not as perfect as one could hope. But suddenly, in the nick of time to save us, come these dynamic languages like Python and Ruby. And also, at this time, the culture in technology development was shifting. We're getting more very small startups. We get a lot of application programmers being pressed in the DBA. Postgres helped this a lot because you didn't have to go and buy Oracle. You downloaded MySQL, you downloaded Postgres, you installed it, you ran it. It basically worked. So why do we need this super expensive DBA for it? The VC's never going to fund one of those anyway. But these people are like, there are three of them in a garage with angel funding trying to bang out this application. They do not have time to learn complicated SQL. Ain't going to happen. There was also a culture shift in this drove the culture shift of databases increasingly being viewed as a data store, as a pure object store, as a place to slam your objects in, because we're losing this sort of ancestral knowledge from the DBAs of enterprise data modeling, and instead it's here's where I put my stuff, my being the application. And then in 2003, Martin Fowler, bless his heart, decided he had invented ORMs because he'd never heard of them before, and published a pattern called Active Record, and from which we get Active Record in Rails. Interestingly enough, I like to say Rails Active Record because Active Record is actually a generic term, the way ORM is a generic term. It's basically a particular architecture of ORM. But the one that everyone knows about is the one Rails implemented, Ruby on Rails, of course. It analyzes the schema and produces the class for you because it's Ruby, you can do anything you want. A lot like Python in that regard. Of course, this does mean the clients of the class have to stay ahead of the interface. So you have to make sure that your code lines up with it because there's no compiler to tell you this all hooks up correctly. But okay, you know, people have infinite patience for this kind of thing in dynamic languages because you need it. And it does require a language that can extend classes on the fly, but Ruby and Python can do that, so we're okay there. This drove a brand new way of looking at ORMs, which was the application down approach, which is Django in Python. The Django framework in Python is the exemplar of this. You define the object model in the application, which of course you do anyway, and then you create the database off of that object model. None of this having to plug into this gross old legacy database. No legacy databases at all. We build the whole database from scratch based on the application's object model. Ooh, that's nice. That'll teach those old SQL people. We don't want to learn SQL, so we're going to create a brand new query language that doesn't look like SQL, and it is better because it doesn't look like SQL. Because we know SQL is bad. And so bang, see, that's not bad, you know. You create this class, and this is the Django tutorial application. And, you know, you create char fields. It's like, this is a whole lot more readable than a create table statement, isn't it? Mm. All right, maybe not. But no one had to write a line of SQL. Yeah, that's great. You are right, and I will tell you exactly how Django programmers. And Python programmers react to your extremely true statement, which is, I can't hear you. No, I don't have to learn any SQL. I don't have to know it's a database. There's a lot of denial. But you're right. You're absolutely right. You do have to know a lot about the data. Ultimately, the database asserts itself, you know, like the bedrock poking through the soil, whether you believe it or not. But first blush, they say, problem solved, we're done. The application writer does not need to learn SQL. And application programmers hate SQL. I cannot emphasize this point enough, because it is almost surreal walking into shops. No, really, they hate SQL. I see people shaking their heads, and I understand on an individual basis, you know, I'm an application programmer, I love SQL, I think it's the coolest thing ever, but you walk into an arbitrary shop, and you say SQL, and it's like the shutters slam down. Of like the whole, you think the whole reason they got into it is because, you know, they were chased around by SQL as a child or something. You know, it's there's really no, the level of resistance to learning SQL is extremely high. And they've accomplished their job, which they think their job is, I need a place to store my objects with a minimum of hassle where I don't have to write a bunch of nasty SQL, I don't have to learn about relational databases. From the point of view of the average application programmer, their problem is solved. And it's important to remember that. And the most important part is they get the demo running up very fast. These frameworks are very fast to get prototypes going. When you deploy them, then you have the problem. But there's even more good news. It doesn't stop there. The application is database independent. Because since this underlying machine is generating the SQL for you, it can figure out all these differences between databases. So you can run SQLite on your laptop and then deploy to Postgres. And because every shop in the middle of the night just wakes up and says, you know, we should move from Postgres to MySQL or back and forth. I mean, this happens all the time, right? They just do this overnight. I mean, it's a very common operation. I'm being sarcastic, of course. But they're sold that this is a really useful feature. At any moment, they could throw a switch and move to a different database. And they don't want to lose this very important feature, he said sarcastically. And you don't have to hire any of those expensive SQL people, except when your application crashes and burns in production. But that's okay, you know, I'm happy for the work. And if we're just stuffing objects in the database, why do we need SQL in the first place? I mean, why do we need this? It's like, wait, light bulb goes on. We're doing all this work just to serialize an object and cram it into a database. What, you know, I mean, come on. You know, my dad used to listen to SQL on his 8-track. This is dad technology. We don't need this anymore. Let's switch to MongoDB. It's web scale. I've heard. My cool friend with the haircut and the fixie told me that it was a web scale database. I should use that instead, because all I'm doing is slamming these objects into it. What could possibly go wrong? Okay, and on this note, we're going to take about a 10-minute break so I can drink my coffee, and we'll be back at 10 minutes to 10. Talking with this gentleman whose name I did not get about the rarely do people do an ORM first technology evaluation. They decide on what language they're going to use or what environment they're going to use. There's often this initial forking of, are we comfortable with the Java ecosystem or aren't we? And if the Java ecosystem these days, basically you're using Hibernate or TopLink or one of the other JPA forms. Then you go down into, then otherwise you would decide, are we, you know, what language are we comfortable with, and then look at the list of ORMs that are available for that language. I kind of like the Django ORM, not because it's, you know, I could spend all day criticizing it, but, you know, what intelligent programmer can't rip that technology to shreds? Nothing special there. But it's nice and basic, it stays out of your way, its failings are easily and are well understood, and that kind of thing. It also, every ORM says, well, but there's absolutely nothing to worry about because you can step aside from it and use raw SQL, which is a little bit like saying, the best part about this car is you can still walk. You know, it's like, that's a weird way of selling you on a piece of technology is, and the best part of this technology is you don't have to use it at all. You can ignore it. In fact, I'm going to stop mentioning it. Just go use SQL, you know, so that's, however, they do, varying ORMs support that kind of step aside to SQL in various ways. Hibernate supports it extremely well because Hibernate, the SQL is right there under the surface. Among the Python ORMs, I think Django does the best. But I don't particularly like Rails, but you know that's almost a religious discussion, so won't go there. Okie dokie. Let's see. So as we discussed, the problem with ORMs is they have these two really different worlds, both technologically and culturally. And they have to fit them together. And things like this happen. This is concept art from the new Von Trier movie, Melancholia. Melancholia smashing into Earth, in case anyone's wondering. So here's a real life case. So now we get to the fun part, which is where we get to trash ORMs. This is always my favorite part, because, you know, who doesn't like trashing things? So we come in, you know, called in as a consultant and says, our database is running really slowly. What is going on? Oh my God, PostgreSQL sucks. So we're checking this batch process that's taking forever to run. And this is what this batch process does when we are looking at the logs. Well, it does begin, okay? Does a select, a single non-join, fetch a single row select, does an update back to that single row, and does a commit, okay? And it does it 1.2 million times every night, executes this loop. But, okay, what it is doing here is adding a constant to one field in each of these records. So I think we found your problem. Because you look at, it was a job, it was Django, and here was, and I have elided almost nothing from this. It was, there was a time counter field, and it was perfectly good Java code, Python code. I mean, if this was an in-memory structure, you know, maybe, I'm sure it's Python, I'm sure you can find a cleverer way of doing it, but you just iterate through all of the query set, which is what Django calls a result set from a query. Increment the number of days this order was open and save it and commit the transaction. Well, that was efficient. So here's problem number one that you come into in ORMs. Is they're using the database as if it was memory because it's an object. Objects are an in-memory paradigm. Ta-da. The database is generally not stored in memory and generally really inefficient to get at as if it were. Even if it's completely and totally cached in memory, this is not exactly the most efficient access pattern ever. But by definition, if this is a persistent store, it has to write to persistent storage. So even if it's all cached in memory, it's having to write to the write-ahead log, it's having to do flush pages at a checkpoint, it's having to do all this stuff that involves log disk access. And this is the fundamental problem. Just because it's easy to do this in Python doesn't mean, or whatever high-level language you're using, doesn't mean it's going to be fast. So, there's one problem that you get into all the time with ORMs. Next one, transaction mismanagement. So let's say, again, I'm using Django because I'm familiar with it and they tend to be small. So I'm going to create a new customer in my record. So, I create this address object, that's nice, and I save it. And I have to do the address first because before I create the customer, because I need to get the foreign key, I need to be able to get a reference back to the customer. So let's see, the order and, the shipping address. Okay, so there we're adding the shipping address to the order. Okay, that'll look fine, and we'll do the same. Okay, that seems reasonable. So let's see what SQL we get out of Django if we don't do anything special. We do an insert, and then we do a commit, and then we insert the order, and then we do a commit. Oh, well, that's kind of not what we wanted, was it? Because, of course, if we have a failure right here, we have this dangling address that's not referred, that's not used by anything. Okay. Yeah, so this is the second problem. Weird transaction models. They generally have the bizarrest transaction models, generally because for a lot of the newer ORMs, for things like Django and Ruby on Rails and things like that, every application framework sort of has their core application in mind, and everything that they do kind of is informed by this application. And for these, it was a blog. Everything was driven by, what do I need to do a really good blog? And the transaction model became, every time you save an object, you save a blog entry, we do a commit. Well, that's kind of not the enterprise approach to transaction management. But they all tend to have these. Hibernate's a notable example, because Hibernate thought this through a little. You know, if nothing else, Hibernate's been around for a long time, so it paid for this in blood for a while. This seems to be the standard default, is every time you do a save an object, it commits it, which is weird if you have dependent objects. And the transaction management tools that you're given are often made to seem like a black art. They're really complicated. Django is particularly bad about this, I will say, is that it seems like they've tried to fix this transaction management problem about 8 times and layered a new layer of weird transaction management tool on top of it. So this kind of weird transaction management is something you'll run into a lot in ORMs. The index to prohibited features. So you come in and you look and the queries are performing badly and you say, well, you know, column. This you're querying this column. Maybe you should index it. Or you say, look, you're doing customers doing a look up across a huge field, say, well, you know, this is really what you're really trying to do is emulate full text search. Postgres has full text search built in. You know, why don't you use that? It's pretty cool. Or it has a built-in point type. You know, you don't need to do have an XY thing and do a query and all this stuff. It's really very nice. Or you have a multi-row constraint which you're enforcing inside the Python, but this bulk import process is running through a different code path and doesn't enforce it, so you're getting data that you think is bad. Just why don't you put in a trigger? And all this stuff. Interestingly, the full text search thing is very frequently you'll find customers running Solr, which is a Lucene-based search engine, not because they've really done a deep analysis and said Solr is superior, but because Solr has a Python interface that's really nice and easy to use. So they figure, well, we need full text search. We can't figure out how to use it through the ORM, so we'll add Solr into the mix to run it. There are people who need Solr as opposed to Postgres's built-in full text search engine, but that's kind of a, but most of the people who do this don't actually need Solr. And this is where we get to the problem of ORMs, is there's the functionality that you end up with is kind of limited. It doesn't expose particular functionality, especially if this is functionality that's unique to a particular database product like Postgres, because they're trying to be database independent for those scenarios where somebody at midnight one day goes, let's switch to MySQL, because that always happens. This is especially bad if special syntax is required. Like in full text search, you need specialized operators. For point search, you need specialized operators. And without dropping down to the raw SQL level, there's no way of pushing the ORM to generate those operations. And this always happens two or three times in presentations. I hit the wrong button here. Bink. Ta-da. This often claimed to be a feature is the problem is when you bring this up on the mailing list and say, well, but there's this problem, there is this kind of la 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 la, but what if we need to convert to MySQL overnight? It's like, that doesn't happen. You know, it's these major database switches are not a common, you know, are not nearly as common as needing one of these features. And but the story is always, but we're database agnostic. That's good, right? You know, it's claimed to be axiom without proof. That does not need to be proved. And frequently, you get at these things is dropping it through SQL, which again seems, you know, is doable, but means that you are once again buying a car just because you can still walk. And application programmers hate SQL. Number of times I get requests like, well, yeah, but can we still do it in Python? And, you know, there, we'll talk about why, what's going on behind this.
Is it more that they hate SQL or the hate SQL queries in their code? Because when you did about these kind of problems, the solution they find is to do procedures.
Well, yeah, we'll actually talk about that. I think the answer is sometimes it's both. Sometimes it's fear of SQL as SQL. The other one is they just don't like the way it looks cluttering up their code with these big raw statements. And there are reasonable arguments they can make about dropping raw SQL, you know, this, you know, a giant raw SQL block, in, you know, just in the middle of their code. There are ways we can fix that problem, of course. But sometimes there is this emotional reaction, and I think that can't be overlooked. But you're right. There are reasonable arguments to be made that, well, do we really want to drop this big hard to maintain piece of SQL, you know, query right in the middle of my otherwise relatively smooth Python. And then there's the opposite problem where the ORM helps too much. Client was getting all these deadlocks. And one of the things that ORMs kind of sell is, well, you're not going to get deadlocks. I've actually had people say, in as many words, it is impossible to get a deadlock if you use an ORM. Which is an interesting definition of the term impossible. Because if you do, in the specific case, you deleted a parent record in a foreign key relationship, it was doing the on-cascade thing. Okay, that's fine. That's actually default in Postgres. That's all right. The problem is that's not what we wanted. Except that relationship wasn't marked that way. It was actually marked as onset null. Okay, that's weird. What's going on here? The problem was excessive health. they finally fixed this, but until the most recent, this is an example. There's plenty of other examples in the order, hoping too much. It was doing it on the leak cascade whether you wanted it or not, and there was no way of turning this off, which is very helpful. Because the reason is SQLite doesn't have cascading triggers, cascading deletes, so we needed to implement it for database agnosticism. Well, that was helpful. Thanks. We appreciate the help. And why that particular feature? Who knows? You know, somebody ran into it. It was quickly slammed into the code base, and it was done. So, again, it's because it's having to, it's trying to be all things to all databases. You're getting these weird extra bits of help. So, who knows why? Yeah. Okay. So. They were doing a summarization operation, and they said, you know, it was like the total on an order or something like that. It was a fairly big one. So we looked at the database activity, and it selected about 125,000 records. Yeah. And did that. Okay. Yeah. So it was dragging in 125,000 records into memory in order to total one field. So this is the reason is, and ironically, this was in Django, and Django supports perfectly nice operations for doing this kind of summarization. Just the syntax on them is really ugly. So, but again, using this in-memory model inappropriately. So yeah, bad supporting. It's either the query reporting is support is bad, or the syntax is gross and horrible, and people don't want to use it. So it should just do a sum, because the problem was, in Django, when if you're going to return these things as objects, it has to have a primary key. But what the primary key for some for reporting queries generally doesn't make much sense. So again, you can drop down to raw SQL, but you kind of get the idea. There's a lot of resistance to that. Memory disasters. So, issued a query for all rows in a 12 million row table, did a sort for the first 10. Did a sort and was only going to take the first 10. And for reasons other, didn't do a limit by. Okay. So, no problem. Django queries are lazy. This actually works okay. Is it doesn't actually evaluate the query until you actually need the results. The problem is it touched the first record. So it did this query, came back, said, okay, I've got your results. It touched the first record, and bang, out of memory. Okay, and then you trace down in the code, and you say, well, Django, layer upon layer, because I'm picky on Django, but that's only because I have the most recent experience fixing Django problems. Layer upon layer, Django is trying to do the right thing. It had generators upon yield operations upon this. It says, well, I'm only going to get the first 20 records and the first 20 records and all the way down through to CyclePG2, which is the most common PostgreSQL library for Python, and saying I'm going to do a fetch one or a fetch many for 20. So please only give me 20 records. So that all seems to be, so why was it running out of memory? Because it really doesn't understand how the DB interface works. It never used the name cursor in any of these operations. And so libpq, if you don't use name cursors, if you're just doing a select, the first time you say, give me the first record, the whole result set gets thrown over the wire. All 12 million records. And there's no clean way of getting around this in Django, because named cursors are fundamentally different SQL API than just doing a strict select. Which is frustrating because CyclePG2 fully supports named cursors, and all you have to do is change the constructor on one object. But Django didn't know to call that. Now that was gross. And, you know, I'm picky on Django, but something else. There's always somewhere where it doesn't really fully understand about how much data is, about these problems of asking for 12 million rows but getting them in bite-sized chunks. Somebody will break it somewhere. Yeah, okay. So, high log usage. This was generating like 12 gigabytes an hour of Postgres logs. These are the text logs, the text logs, not the redhead logs. Not the X logs. Well, that's kind of not good. And the parameters weren't set very clearly, so that's not so good. And there were individual queries that were nearly 100,000 characters long, which is what and they were generating a lot of them, which is why these logs were filling up so fast. So because this is what they were doing for these, basically it was doing a query and then building a list of values off of that query, which was about 1,000, 2,000, 5,000 odd integers. And then just passing it in for an in, which generated this. And again, this is really very concise in Python. Shame it generates this about as bad as it possibly could be operation in there. So, and it was doing this in a tight loop. It was doing thousands of these a minute. So, and the problem here is a feature mismatch between between SQL and the programming language you're writing that calls the OR. It really, you can do bad queries really easily. If you wrote that in SQL, you'd notice that you were doing this really horrible query. In Python, it looks great. What could possibly be wrong with that? And if you don't look at the underlying SQL, you never see it. All you'd have to do is look at the end of the log and see, you know, tailing the log immediately made it clear what the problem was. But remember, this client had for a while, like a week, been generating 12 gigabytes of log an hour and didn't want to look at the SQL. There was almost a physical fear of looking at that log for fear of what they might find. Which is, so it was worth them paying our hourly rate. You know, it's like the ultimate in the plumber of, yes, I could use it, but I really don't want to go into the back. I don't even want to look at the clogged toilet. You do it, please. And this is not unique. Okay. Bad idioms. So this is, I don't know, are people familiar in Postgres with this problem of foreign key deadlocks? Where two operations, because of the way, when you update a record that's a child record to a parent record in a foreign key, Postgres takes a share block on that parent record, and this can create deadlocks even if you're doing all the right things in terms of order of operation. Not familiar with this problem? You're lucky. It's a really pain in the neck to debug. But there is this problem in Postgres where if you take it, Postgres takes a lock on a parent record if you modify a dependent record in a foreign key relationship, and that can create a surprising deadlock situation depending on. The solution in this generally is if you're modifying both the parent record and the secondary record, you modify the parent record first, not second, not first. And so it's easy to work around, but unfortunately that's not the way active record works in Rails. It does it does it in the wrong order from Postgres' point of view, and it's really hard to override this behavior. So Rails on Postgres gets lots of these foreign key deadlocks, and of course the problem is Postgres sucks. So yeah, unhelpful standard behavior. So this can there is a patch going in that will reduce the likelihood of this deadlock situation. Just in case I just panicked you about Postgres, but. But again, deadlocks are a scary thing to most application programmers because one of the rules they're told over and over again is if you do the operations in the same order every time, you won't get deadlocks. And so when a deadlock occurs, it has to be a Postgres bug. And they can be really difficult to track down, especially if you don't have any data. You know, finding the source of it, if you have zero database skill, finding the source of a deadlock can be really challenging. Okay, so there are eight very common problems that I've run into all the time on ORMs. But you know, they're using ORMs, you know, kind of, why should we care? Well, they did it to themselves. These problems are blamed on the RDBMS, not the ORM. That's the problem, is that every single one of those was originally presented to us as, why is Postgres doing the wrong thing? And for everyone where they do call in a consultant and they come in and fix it, we explain it to them and show them how there's another three or four that are out there saying, you know, these stupid RDBMSs, this wouldn't have happened if I was using MongoDB. Which is true for some, to an extent, but of course you have other problems. And also, even if they are calling them to fix it, we're the kind of people who are being called in to fix these problems. So it's creating, you know, especially if you're in-house, it's creating work for yourself that you probably didn't need. And as mentioned, this is one of the primary drivers behind the NoSQL movement, is all I'm doing is slamming this object in and getting it back out. I have one application. It's the only application that will ever talk to a database. And this is a very routine comment I hear, is I've written my application. We're never going to do, there's never going to be any other application until the heat death of the universe that will ever need to look at this data. And then, of course, they say, well, but except for management reports. Well, we'll write management reports through the web application. We'll run great. And if this is the only thing you're going to do with a database, why go through all this trouble of an RDBMS? You know, like PostgreSQL has tuning parameters. You know, Berkeley DB doesn't have tuning parameters. Why do I include tuning parameters? So there's all the bad stuff. Now, what do we do about this? How do we fix these problems that are being thrown at us? Any questions before I move on to the terraforming of Mars here? Nope. Good. So the first problem, of course, is every ORM has its own idiosyncrasies. Every ORM is, you know, as they say, you know, all unhappy ORMs are unhappy in their own way. The good part is, but you kind of there these patterns start emerging about ORM-related problems. Now, just to get the bad news out of the way, there are some fixes that are not quick fixes, and will have to be sold because you actually require code changes, you know, or architectural changes. But the good news is some you can go in and plug pretty easily. Okay. This is, I would say, ORM problem number one, is pathological iteration. Generally, this involves reading something in, processing it, writing it back out, over and over and over again. Storing large result sets in application objects, also doing large in-memory sorts inside the application is an extremely common ORM-related problem. Select update loops. Incrementing a single field and writing it back out, for example. Generally what you want to do is, this is replacing with stored procedures to single update statements. Now, this will require either raw SQL or a compliant ORM. Replacing with a single update statement depends. Hibernate's pretty good at this. The Active Record, Django, Esh ones, not so much. You sometimes do have to draw SQL to do that. But the other thing you can do is replace it with stored procedure. Now, I will say, for a lot of clients, when you use the term stored procedure, immediately hives develop, because it's another piece of code that's outside of their control, frequently written in another language that they're going to have to manage. And now Postgres is in a great position for this because unlike a lot of databases, you can drop in things in Python and other than languages that they probably know, unlike having to do it just in an SQL-based language. But there's the solution there. Transaction problems. Little teeny tiny transactions that don't really encompass the entire work. Transactions that are left open between requests. This is a big problem in a lot of ORMs if you're using any kind of connection pooler, because the framework will forget to close the transaction or leave it open, and then you have there's a notorious problem in Django about leaving connections in idle and transaction state, which no one can seem to find. I've tried, but I can't seem to find it. And as the previous example. A transaction doesn't completely bracket an atomic sequence, where the work is not enclosed in a single transaction. So this is just a research problem. Is that all modern ORMs have some way of managing this problem? The problem is they're usually obscure, ill-documented, hard to find, and the first round of code didn't use them correctly. So, and sometimes you need to do some re-architecture if the work is spread out over multiple methods or something like that, where it's not easily fixable. And the query train wrecks, queries with gigantic predicates. For example, people grabbing one result set and slamming it into another one to do a large in or exists. Bad automatically generated joins. You know, this is held up as being the big problem with ORM, so actually I don't see it as often as I used to. Part of it is that if you're the syntax for most ORMs for doing manual large joins is so god-awful, people don't want to use it. Instead, the bigger problem is that they abandon joins and start doing in-memory joins. Very large select lists. This is generally, most ORMs will request all the fields of a table back. If you start doing joins, it'll start requesting all the fields of all the tables back. This sounds bad. The reality is this tends to be a secondary problem unless there's a really huge result set, at which point the combinatorics start getting, you know, that multiply operation starts killing you. In smaller queries, yeah, whatever. Most ORMs have some way of slicing the object down so you only get part of it back. This is more common in dynamic languages because dynamic languages tend to be more tolerant of unset fields than compiled languages. So here we're starting to get to a more general solution, which is, again, you're not going to get rid of the ORM because the ORM is providing a very valuable service to the application programmer, which is adapting the database into terms that they can understand and use in the form of an object API. But what so the thing to do is if you have to do this handcrafted SQL store procedures, wrap it in an application API. Don't expect people to just dump this raw SQL straight into their code, because it is a maintenance nightmare. They're absolutely right. It requires them to shift conceptual gears when they're reading it. And frequently, the people who understand this SQL are not going to be the people who are called in to maintain it. So what I'm getting at with this is start thinking in terms of less that the ORM is one component of a database access layer. And then now we have the join landslides, specifically joins done manually in the application. So like I said, the syntax in Django, for example, for doing a join across multiple tables is god-awful. I don't understand why people think this is an improvement over SQL, because it's this endless series of method calls to compose this gigantic object. It's really ugly. But yet, somehow this is easier than SQL. I don't get it. So they say, well, I'm not going to do that. So instead, I'm going to suck in all these tables, and I'm going to do the join inside the application. And why not? Python is great. You know, one of the things that's great about Python is it's got data, you know, its data structure manipulation primitives are wild. So they don't use it. And they're also sometimes not thinking in SQL terms. They're not thinking of this as a join. They're thinking, what if these data structures already existed in memory and I just had to do this correlation? So they use, you know, for loops and all sorts of exciting things. And I guess there's no solution to this problem. Anyway, the solution here is either educate them about the join syntax, or again, find a way of wrapping the raw SQL inside of an API. Caching disasters. Now this is something I didn't mention earlier, which is most ORMs, not all, but most, do some kind of caching. Every ORM implicitly does some caching because the very fact that you are holding this row as an object in memory is a cache. And you have to kind of treat it that way because if something is happening in the underlying database, this cache could be invalidated. Virtually no ORMs have a mechanism for doing this. Hibernate kind of does. The active record family just ignores the problem and puts their fingers in their ears. It's like, we don't understand what you're talking about caching. All ORMs cache by their nature. Anytime you have this record in memory, it's a cache of the underlying data. But they almost none of them do intelligent cache validation. It's a hard problem, first of all, and it's not a problem that's universally applicable in a simple in simple applications. You may not need this kind of cache validation. So, and being a hard problem, they figure application programming problem. So if necessary, you can do a read after write. This is a place where triggers and stored procedures can be very useful, is if they have multiple access to the same row and you're not holding persistent, you can do it with locking, of course, but you really want to not do a lot of row locking if you're holding an object for read, because you're going to start single threading the application through that row. So you can reread it after write, restore procedures. Another big problem is if you're using master-slave replication, is how are you dealing with replication lag? In 9.0, for example, Postgres 9.0, very nice feature, which is you can do primary-secondary replication, you can do a write into the master, and then it'll replicate it out to the slaves. Well, that's great. Django, for example, has a very nice feature where you can direct the writes to one database and the reads from other databases. It works great, as long as you don't expect it to be instantly rereadable. So you do have to think about how to handle this problem. Frequently, you can handle this problem just by using good idioms, is understanding that when you do a write, it may be a while before this is propagated out, so don't expect to be able to do an instant read on it. So it depends on the idiom. You frequently solve this problem idiomatically, but if you're starting to get bugs in a replicated environment where the objects seem to be mysteriously changing values, that's probably what's going on. Yep, problems with planner. This is the Java problem, because the hibernate problem. Some ORMs really love prepared statements. Hibernate loves prepared statements. Without heroic efforts, it will do everything as a prepared statement. And the problem is, Postgres this is why you like prepared statements, is that you reduce the planner overhead. So you only do the plan once a session. So you get the query, it plans it, it caches the plan. That is either good or bad, depending on how much you're changing the underlying parameters. If the underlying parameters are very, very similar one after another, it's a win because you didn't have to redo the replanning. If the parameters are wrong, or worse yet, this is a stored procedure that you're calling with lots of, like one of them is a hidden stored procedure, then the plans could be completely off. And unfortunately, this is really all what you have to do, is issue a discard plans to force it to release these plans if this is the problem that you're getting. Indexing problems. You get lots and lots of these. Either the columns aren't indexed at all because it's not clear. But this is one of my favorite trick questions is, what's required in the SQL standard as far as indexes go? What's the minimum requirement for index support? Trick question. Indexes aren't mentioned in the SQL standard. They are entirely an implementation feature. So if an ORM is being a database agnostic, sometimes they'll ignore indexes entirely. There are fewer and fewer, but there have been ORMs that say, oh yeah, indexes, well, your DBA will take care of those. So two other problems. You can have the wrong kind of indexes, because the syntax, frequently the syntax for creating an index is, oh, you just tag this option onto an individual field that says index this for me. So that's not great if you want a multi-column index or a functional index, which is frequently a huge, huge win in Postgres. Or you have too many indexes because the application programmer just said, oh, well, I'm going to index anything that's mentioned in a query ever. And basically every single field, including giant text indexes, really expensive stuff, it has an index. So the fix here is just about every ORM has a way of dropping into raw SQL during database creation time if you're using the ORM to drive the database creation. So create the indexes there. Yeah, come back here you. And prune down the indexes by looking at what's actually being used. This ability to issue raw SQL to create the column is very handy for doing functional indexes. And some miscellaneous debugging tips. ORM calls can be really hard to correlate with database activity. This is a very common situation, is that you see a call in the database, and you need to find which line in the application program actually did it, and it can be really complicated because by the time the ORM's done, it can kind of look nothing like the original call. I wish I had a brilliant, super easy suggestion for this, but what I tend to do is inject a lot of, in debug mode only, a lot of statements of the form select with where I am in, as a text string, just to get a trace of where it's going. If you also have access, if you can issue raw XGO, you can issue raise notifies or things like that. As an application design thing, be very liberal with these, and you can switch them off if you're running in production, so you don't get that log cluttered up with them. Turn up Postgres logging. Really use the use it auto explain. Have a relatively short window for how for statement logging, and use pgfuin. It's a log analyzer to digest out the logs and look for really, really busy logs. I mean, this is good advice for databases, for database performance in general. But ORM operations usually are lazy. They usually don't happen at the point that the query is created. They happen at the point the query is executed, or in the results are needed. And in some ORMs, it's a very common idiom to create a query and then pass it around for a while before anyone actually touches it and tries to get results out of it. Again, Django, SQL Alchemy, both of those, this is a very common idiom, is one function will create a query and then hand it over, and then some other thing will finally start getting results out of it, and it's at the point the first results are required that it's actually executed. Okay. Time for another break. We'll come back at 20 till, and then conclude, and we'll send you all on your way. Plow through the last section here and get everyone to lunch. So, all right, now that we've trashed ORMs thoroughly, what's the future? What do we do? We have the two exoplanets happily orbiting the same sun. I don't think we can really be that close to each other. So, one thing, that's, despite the amount of trashing that I've done on ORMs here, one thing I do want to get across is ORMs intrinsically aren't evil. There's a lot of categorical statements you will hear in the database community about the problem is ORMs. And the problem is not ORMs per se, any more than it is, you know, C language per se. They're invaluable for their core operation, which is object persistence. That's what they're good at. They do it very well. They've had decades now to get that problem pretty much under control. And no one is going back to the old school of application interfacing. It's not going to happen. So ORMs are a reality that we're going to have to, we will have to approach, and we will have to come up with strategies for. Most of the problems come from this hammer-nail attitude of, we've got an ORM, that's how we get our database. If we want to do a join, we use the ORM. If we want to do a mass update, we use the ORM. Everything has to go through the ORM. It has to go through the ORM using the ORM's native APIs. And culturally, ORMs have been pitched as a way not to learn SQL. One thing that ORMs can be legitimately accused of is they've created this world in which where it's bad. If you have to learn SQL, it's a failure on the part of the technology, and that's an attitude we have to fight. So one action is, well, why don't we just do a better ORM already? Right, an ORM that doesn't have all these problems. That is not the answer. Okay, we have to stop chasing after this illusionary ORM that's off in the sunset, you know, like a mirage beckoning us. ORMs have been around since the early 1990s at the latest. I'm sure there are ORMs you can find even earlier than that. If we could fix it with better technology, we would have by now. The ORM space is very thoroughly explored. If there were an easy technology fixed all these problems, we would have nailed it. And virtually all production ORMs have a way of solving these problems by now, even if it means stepping outside the ORM itself and going to the raw SQL. Because the people who are actually building these ORMs, by and large, have hit these problems. These problems are not new to the ORM implementers. But we're not taking advantage of them when we build our applications. Everything that we've talked about can be fixed here. But there are different kinds of fixes for different layers of the problem. There are some technology fixes. There are a lot of educational fixes. and there are management level fixes that we need to apply. So, better application architectures. This is great if you happen to be in a place of having be able to architect an application from the start. Not always the case. Don't have the primary interface be the ORM. Now that seems like just contrary to everything an ORM is about, but it's actually, the problem is ORMs are a relatively low-level technology. They, from the point of the application, they're the lowest level in the database access stack. They're like the stream when you're going after a file. They're very low, they're a very primitive operation, and yet they're the only API that we're exposing. So it's a low-level component. So push the interface up to the next layer and have the ORM be one of the components that interface accesses. And it gives you, basically, this is giving you a rope to sweep the SQL under. If you need to do custom SQL, it gives you a place to put it that's parallel to the ORM, that's parallel to the ORM, and that is not directly exposed to the application program. We can do some friendlier database design. One thing you can do is turn the database into the application server. Postgres is uniquely well suited for this particular solution. Have the API to the database be through stored procedures rather than direct table access. That's one possibility. Create views. Views are very nice. Generally interact with ORMs pretty well if you can get around the primary key requirement problem, is a little bit nasty, but you can figure out ways. So, for example, you can encapsulate big joins inside of views rather than expect the application programmer to know them directly. This is a very strong PostgreSQL point, which is use a familiar language for stored procedure implementation. It doesn't have to be PLPGSQL. There's PLPythonU, there's PLPerl, there's PLJava, there's all these things. A lot of the resistance simply comes from the fact that from a procedural point of view, they don't know these languages, and having 12 pages of PLPGSQL thrown at the application programmer is pretty intimidating. So, you can wrap up the SQL in the sugarcoating of either Python or Perl. Working with a client long enough, it finally came down to, we just don't want the procedural part in PLPGSQL because we don't know that stuff. Can you implement the sort of procedure in Perl? It's like, well, thank goodness you're on Postgres. So, and a lot of background operations can be pushed outside of, like batch loading, daily update processes. You can push these outside of the ORM because they're not core to the application and achieve significant speedups that way because they don't have to go through the ORM layer. And there's a lot more receptiveness to using raw SQL. So a few just basic tips. Web developers tend to be really focused on the front-end OLTP, and they view everything through that lens. What can I do to do the online transaction processing? That's what the web application is to them. And from that point of view, what they need is an object store, and so everything's viewed through that object store lens, and the ORM is the obvious solution. So one thing that we can do as database people is make them aware of the issues involving data warehousing and analysis architecture, because this is where the ORMs generally bomb. Is when you're trying to do these operations that SQL was originally designed to support. I mean, SQL was not originally intended as a, I'm going to store tiny little data objects in a database kind of language. It does it okay, but select was intended to a much bigger axe than just writing single rows. It was intended for these big data warehouses. So the more we can explain why these exist, the more receptive the application programmers will be. It doesn't hurt to point out that people who know SQL are in demand and well compensated to application programmers. And it's a career development opportunity. So yes, there's things we can teach. This is one of the reasons that drives me nuts, is that the whole way we teach SQL to application programmers is wrong. We teach it like a command language. It's like connect and type a select and see things come back. Well, that's great, but that is showing a very limited aspect of what SQL is about. SQL is sort of the tip of the whole relational model iceberg, and approaching it from this is kind of like the hello world way of teaching a programming language. You know, it's like you don't really learn the programming language, you just learn a tiny bit of its syntax. So teach the relational model instead. This is because the select and SQL and its friends make a whole lot more sense if you're thinking about the data from the point of view of the relational model rather than this is just a place for my stuff. And programmers generally love efficiency. They want to do things, they want to make the best use of the resources they're given, mostly their time, and that is one of the reasons ORMs are so popular, is it saves them a lot of time. But this is a golden opportunity to explain to them how to deliver this kind of stuff more efficiently. For example, one of the reasons that ORMs tend to fall down, and direct SQL is better, is that we want to reduce the data as much as possible on the server rather than ship it across the wire and analyze it. And virtually any competent programmer will understand that that's a real problem. And also, they need to understand that databases are a discipline, that just like object-oriented programming is a discipline, systems engineering and network engineering are disciplines. It's not a priesthood. This is not some magical thing you have to learn. It's just a technology. So, more education fixes. This is a problem I've run into in a lot of shops is developers are using a system other than production database systems. Like, they'll use SQLite for production, for development, and then deploy on Postgres because they think that somehow they can't run Postgres on their laptops. I mean, Postgres runs great on a laptop. But the problem here, this has two problems. One is it's giving them a bad idea of what a relational database is capable of in terms of functionality. If they had that functionality sitting right in front of them, they'd take more advantage of it. Also, it drives home this idea that the database agnosticism of ORMs is the most important feature in the entire world because without otherwise they can't easily switch from production to development. So move development on to use the production database on during development. Teach them to tail the logs. Even if they don't fully understand every SQL statement, there are a lot of problems that just appear out of nowhere if you are, or their sources appear out of nowhere if you are looking at what the database activity really is. I mean, it's just profiling. And if you start seeing these thousand item in clauses, you'll know that your application's broken. You will have to overcome the visceral dislike of looking at SQL, but this is important. It's a career development opportunity. And again, I'm hammering on this. Teach the relational model. Teach why the data is structured this way, not just, oh, you issue a select to get the data. Okay, moving up the organizational stack here. Most technology things these days, especially in startups, happen bottom up, but top down has its role. No application is pure OLTP. This is the big lie of the web framework. Is that everything is designed to support the OLTP of the web front end, but it's not, you always have to do management reports. You always have to do data warehousing. This will come up in any real business that's successful. There is no business in the world that's pure 100% non-OLTP. And if you do this, this costs real money. You have to pay the consultant to come in to fix the problem. You have to buy a bigger machine to support the transaction load. And this stuff isn't free. And especially now that so many companies are running on web hosting or on shared hosting environments, where they're paying, where the meter is running every time it does one of these. It's not just a matter of buying a bigger box. Then you can point to the spikes in actual dollar cost. You know, hardware, virtual server time. And you know, remember those expensive SQL consultants? You know, it's very important to bring these skills in-house because you don't want to have to always be picking up the phone and calling somebody like PostgreSQL experts to come in and fix the problem. So, getting to the conclusion here. ORMs are great for the problem they were designed to solve, which is creating objects out of database rows. That was the problem they were designed to solve. Pretty much they've solved that problem by now. It's done. They're good, they're really good at it. They do the job. The pathologies that we've been talking about come from pushing them beyond that design center. So when you are stepping outside that design center is when ORMs start breaking. And there's really nothing for, you know, that we have to assume at this point we've gone as far as we can with the basic ORM model. You know, tomorrow somebody might revolutionize it and my jaw will drop and everything will be great. I don't expect that because after 20 years, we kind of figured it out. So don't do that. Don't use ORMs for these for large data reduction operations, for batch processing, for the things that they're just not good at. So learning to love the ORM. So, and you know, ORMs are tools just like any of these other tools. They're very useful in their proper place. They're painful if you grab the wrong end. And you need to confirm ORMs as they are, not as the ORMs you like them to be. You know, so these general hand-wavy, oh, if only ORMs were better, we wouldn't have this problem. That's not going to happen. ORMs are what they are. They're knowledge is power. So, you know, as DB people, we have to understand why these tools. And just like we need to understand SQL, and that's part of our job, unfortunately. And the better we can understand them, the better we can help the application programmers. And it's one more valuable skill in R and your professional toolkit. And that's my presentation. Thank you very much. So, last questions, comments, pieces of some value. Yes.
I don't quite agree I think there are improvements that can be made to more of these. I think the reason we haven't seen those improvements is they're not complete. So, for example, developers like writing, I want to iterate through this record set and do these operations. A really good next generation RM would be able to look at that code and say, you're incrementing this field. I know what you're doing, update, set, blah, and actually.
You can certainly imagine an ORM that like plugged into the middle of an LVVM compiler and emitted SQL. You know, that's an imaginable thing. And I think that would be great. You know, obviously technology is not going to stop. I don't need to oversell that point. It's more that there's a reaction of if only I didn't have to worry about ORMs. You know, and unfortunately that's not the world as it is.
The other thing is that I think one of the biggest problems in ORMs 1 and 2 is that they don't understand that very early on is when it is the most critical for them to get access to somebody who understands relational theory. And yes, maybe they can't afford to hire somebody. Maybe it doesn't even make sense. I mean, there's a lot of work with developers. I think if we can start making people aware that, you know, if you make some bad choices early on, it's going to have a stupendous impact.
Yep.
And just getting them open to the idea of, you know, bring a consultant in for a day every month or something like that, just to look at, you know, here's what we're doing right now, what do you think, what are we missing?
You know, to be slightly cynical, but I think accurate about it, there's an argument to be made that over the last 15 years, the success of technology has largely been related to how fast it gets you your first round. And ORMs are really great for pulling together demos.
Sure.
You know, and that's been one of the driving factors behind them. And unfortunately, by the time what most first round funders don't want to hear is, okay, now we're going to go build the real one.
Right.
And that's, so you're stuck. I'm agreeing with you that yes, we need to, if you design your application from the beginning to understand that you'll do ORM things using the ORM and non-ORM things not using the ORM, you'll be in much better shape. And unfortunately, when people are, you know, working the 16 hours, 7 days a week to try and, try and impress somebody, that frequently goes by the wayside, which is unfortunate. But another question in those comments. Did I say that was wrong? Yes.
You talked a little bit about the transactional issues around ORMs, and there are solutions, but I didn't see anything about what those possible solutions might be.
Well, most ORMs have transactional. There's sort of two ways you can do it. There's the data that there's from the you can just do really strict convention. For example, you can say every time every user operation runs inside of a single transaction, and most ORMs will have, like, sometimes the framework will have direct support for that, and that's great as long as that works. You know, it's usually okay for a first cut, and then start falling apart. Most ORMs do have reasonably good transactional support, but you have to teach people about transactions and drill in about what a transaction actually means. And this is so you can bracket things inside of you can actually add the transactions manually into the view function or the view operation or the controller operation or whatever you're actually doing. Well, I didn't go into it too much because it's ORM specific one way or another. Like the Python ones tend to have a whole family of decorators that you can throw on to say, okay, this function runs inside of a single transaction, and don't abort if an exception flies out from a commit if it completes. And that's nice because I like those if you can, because those express transactions in a way that makes sense to an application programmer. You can say all the database operations in this function will complete as a single unit. And that's much easier than sort of saying, oh, and here's a save point, and here's a save point, and here's a save point. Of course, if you have an application program sophisticated enough to use save points, you're in great shape. But. Anything else? Questions, comments? Anybody else disagree with me, please? Yes?
One of the compromises with ORMs is that they try to be database agnostic or database product agnostic. Mm-hmm. So I believe that if you have an ORM that's very targeted towards a database specific product, such as Link in Microsoft, targeted for purely SQL Server, that there are certain optimizations that can be.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And there's database agnostic and database agnostic. There is one of them. There's database agnosticism I can support, which is that the ORM is potentially capable of running on any type of database. Because especially if you're an open source project and you're looking for large acceptance, you probably don't want to pick a specific database. Of course, I wish they would all just say, well, Postgres and everyone else can go hang, but they're not going to do that. There's database agnosticism of, we will refuse to support advanced features of a database because for fear that somebody, having spent their first 2 years running on this database, will switch to this other one. And I think that's not being realistic about deployment environments. It's never, that was my joke about, it's not going to happen that somebody, at midnight is going to say, forget it, we're switching for underlying programs, database in production. That's, it's like saying, that's such a huge nightmare the ORM level support is your least of your problems on that point. So, having something like a really Postgres-specific ORM would be kind of cool. Of course, then there's two ends to it, because all ORMs, by their nature, are very tied to the object model of a particular language. So you would have to have a Python Postgres ORM and a Java Postgres ORM, and that's a very specialized whack of code. Of course, companies do build their own ORMs, and they frequently do make those decisions. Yes?
I was going to say that ORMs do have optimizations for a specific database state. They are not necessarily agnostic completely. If you use MySQL, they're going to use certain statements. If it's Postgres, they're going to change the syntax that they send.
Oh, absolutely. Some of them are just adaptive things where there's no real performance benefits, just what you have to do because every database has its own syntax. And some of them will take advantage of underlying database features. It depends on the philosophy of the particular ORM, how aggressive they get about that kind of thing. In the case of like the Django example I gave, they were busily emulating deleting, cascading, in the case that you were running on MySQL or MySQL without InnoDB or SQLite, and that's kind of, that's kind of broken. But unfortunately, it means that if you want to really take advantage of advanced features, not a lot of ORMs will like be smart enough to switch to using Postgres full text search, or things that are very specific to a particular database.
I really don't want to make a case for pursuing database agnostic system, but I do have to say that every job I've worked at for the last decade has involved major database transitions where you decide that you don't want to use Oracle anymore, you want to move to Postgres or something like that, and or a lot of writing new code to tie together different RDBMSs, or seeing people work with Informatica or other tools like that to do work around with that, but things are applied to the database, so I really database, but
oh, you know, it's a lot. No, of course, it really does happen that you switch underlying database products. And if you're writing a packaged application that has to run across multiple database products, then you're in a different world. And, you know, you have this different set of constraints. Like, it's like the EAP thing. It's like that's one of the few times that the EAP schema actually kind of makes sense. But you inevitably, there's going to be, it's how much, and this is more, this is a technical, sort of a management decision, is how much are you going to pay for that agnosticism? You know, how much is that worth to you? Are you going to, for example, go with, ignore useful specific database features in order to allow for this transition in the future? And there's no one answer to that. I think companies ORM developers can oversell database agnosticism a bit as a more common operation than it is. I mean, companies don't do this willy-nilly. And when you're going to make one of these transitions, it's a big deal. And inevitably, there will be code that has to change no matter what. So, anyway. But yes, of course it does happen. Absolutely. That was sort of my packaged application comment. If you're developing a packaged application as opposed to in-house technology that's going to, you know, that you're putting in production locally, then you have a slightly different set of constraints. Just like if you needed to build across multiple operating systems, you know, or something like, you know, or any of these, if you want to support both BSD and Linux, you know, then you're going to have other constraints. And that's a specific set of concerns. And then you have other concerns like, how modifiable do you want the schema to be? You know, and or do you modify the schema? Do you let people modify the schema in the field, or do you use EAB type approach to modify the schema? So yes, yeah, absolutely. Oh, yes, I'll get back.
Hi, I'm
This is one of the things that we find that ORMs are a big victory, is that you don't have these selects and, you know, other small operations scattered through this entire code base. Frequently, for languages that are and interface libraries where it's still a problem, means more resistance to injection attacks, because the ORM gives you a one-stop shop for cleaning the code. So, you know, ORMs are great for that kind of thing. Absolutely, it's when you start moving outside the design center they start coming into play. That's a very nice feature. It would be nice if more ORMs did allow you to do these queries as two-step processes, where you let it generate the query and then allow programmatic intervention. It's a little bit fragile because it constrains the ORM developer in the way they can. If you have something that really relies very deeply on the parse tree of a particular query, and that means the ORM developer, that part the output of that process is suddenly becoming part of the ORMs API. And you might want to think twice about whether or not this is, you know, I'd hate a new version of the ORMs break all my code because the parse tree changed, you know, because the ORM developer got smarter about how to write a join or something like that. But in theory, there's a lot to be done for that. I mean, one of the nicest things that Django did in the version before last was let you issue raw SQL queries but still construct those as proper objects. And that was a big step forward. Because before that, you either had to manually create the objects or just use associative arrays as the output if you did raw SQL, which meant there was this huge dividing line between the ORM world and the raw SQL world. And adding the ability to create proper model objects from raw queries was a big step forward. So ORM technology continuing to advance has definitely had its place. It's just I'm looking for incremental, not revolutionary changes in technology going forward. Great, thank you very much.